decided to trade him away and get some prospects.
Bet him had played for the Braves for parts of 2004, 05, and 06. Miner ready for the 2-0. Sunday hop right to Pasternicki. Throw a little bit low, but Freeman does a good job of digging it out, saving an error. So the hit by Johnson, all the Orioles can muster in the first. No score, bottom half of the first coming up. Skipper. As a coach under Bobby Cox, third base coach for 4 years before becoming the manager for the Florida Marlins. What an eventful year number one it was for Freddie at the helm. Starting lineup for the Braves. Again, most of the regulars in the lineup today. Bourne, Prado, and McCann. Brian will be DHing today. Uglett, Jones, and Freeman in the middle. Baraz, Pasternicki, and Boscan will compose of the bottom third of the lineup. As Brian mentioned, Peraz is a guy that's had a terrific spring. Pasternicki, these games extremely important for a guy like Pasternicki.
These guys have to make an impression, and you know Pasternicki's getting off to a slow start, and you know, you start reading your clippings in the offseason where all of a sudden, hey, I might be the starting shortstop, and everybody expected Pasternicki to probably spend another year or two in Triple-A minor leagues, but didn't happen. Frank Ring couldn't pull off a deal for a shortstop, and they're putting that money down on Pasternicki, and he just has to relax, go out there and let his talents take over, because he has the talent.
He's found himself in a big battle with Andrelton Simmons for the starting shortstop job. Simmons has been terrific, has unbelievable defensive skills, a cannon of an arm. They've both been somewhat on par at the plate.
I talked to Chipper earlier, and man, he likes this kid.
Here's Michael Bourne. In his first complete year with Atlanta. Watches one for a strike. Jason Hamill is on the mound for Baltimore. All 6 feet, 6 inches of him. Swing and a miss.
Oh, Michael Bourne wasn't trying to slap that ball anyway. He was trying to take that ball over the wall. That was a big swing by Michael Bourne.
Breaking ball doesn't miss by much. Hamill, a 10th round draft pick of the Rays back in 2002. Bourne got handcuffed on that one, and the throw to first to complete the strikeout, one gone.
A nasty slotted down and in. Bourne had an aggressive attitude at it, but it's a bad pitch to swing.
Now Martin Prado. And this is one of those guys.
I mean, that ball clearly down and in, bounces before it even gets to the plate. He was in that protect mode, just didn't get the bat on the ball.
Prado hammers the first pitch, a slicer foul and out of play. Martin Prado, who actually finished ninth in the National League MVP voting 2 years ago. He was leading the National League in batting average middle of the season. Had a terrific 2010, an all-star campaign. Takes strike two. And then last year had the staph infection, had some injuries, got off to a slow start. And it was just a year that Martin Prado would just as soon forget.
Well, if you remember, he got hot around All-Star break and had that staph infection to start the second half and really turned his season around, trying to come back from that staph infection. The Braves trade for Michael Bourne, and he lost his aggressiveness trying to hit behind Michael Bourne. Now he's trying to go back to that aggressive attitude and return to the Martin Prado.
1-2 is sky to right. Beerer puts it away for out number two. And when you look at Prado and what he did last year, he batted 260, and everybody to a man realizes Martin Prado's a better hitter than that.
No question about it. I mean, 260 is not bad for a lot of people. But Prado, you expect 300 every year. I mean, he's that type of hitter, very consistent.
You see the Orioles defense brought to you by VisitFlorida.com. And the first pitch, a called strike to Brian McCann, hitting 308 this spring. Has there been a more consistent Brave the last 4 or 5 years than this guy?
Absolutely not. And to be a catcher, and you know, the biggest problem that Brian McCann has is at the end of the season at Atlanta Heat, he kind of fatigues at the end of the season, and he's been really working on his conditioning to hopefully make that go away, but it's just tough. I mean, to be a catcher and catch so many games, it's hard not to be fatigued by the end of the season. And that Atlanta Heat, we all know how hot it is in Atlanta and down south.
You can chalk it up every year. Brian McCann, all-star. 1-2 pitch, sky to short left. O's coming on. And a rather quiet 1-2-3 inning for the Braves in the first. We head to inning number two, no score here from Central Florida. On the top of the second, Braves fans, come enjoy the free Braves open house on March the 31st. Fans will be able to enjoy free Scouts Alley games, clubhouse tours, and kids run the bases. The Braves will also host a Waffle House charity breakfast served by Braves alumni. Go to Braves.com open house for more details. Alongside Brian Jordan, Mike Morgan, great to be with you here at Champion Stadium. The 15th year the Braves have called this complex home in spring training. Paulino cuts and misses, 0-2 the count.
Well, Mike Mina starting out with that fastball for a strike, getting ahead of hitters. And that pitch there, a nasty changeup. Paulino out in front. Good waist pitch there. I really like what I see so far out of Mike Mina. He's being efficient, not wasting a lot of pitches. He's around the plate. This is a big difference for Mike Minor. You can almost see the confidence and see how he's relaxed out there. He's in control.
1-2 pitch, high and tight. We're talking with some of the coaches. This year, Mike Minor feels like he belongs. He's not trying to fit in anymore. He's been there, done that at the big league level. He's shown he belongs there. He's already slated to pitch in the rotation. Last year, he was just fighting to make the ball club. 2-2 pitch. Lofted in the air and flagging it down is Prado on his trot for out number one. But that's got to make a huge difference for a pitcher, Brian, knowing that, well, surely you'd like to pitch well in spring training, but you don't have to fight for a job. You pretty much already have one.
Well, fans don't understand how much pressure can make a difference in a player. And right now he's pitching without the pressure, where the last couple years he's been pitching with that pressure. And that's something that Tyler Pastrnicki is going through right now. You know, he's putting that added pressure on himself because he knows he has a chance to be the starting shortstop. And for a young kid, that's tough. It's really tough.
Beer, the right fielder in the box. Two balls, no strikes. And Miner was a guy that, speaking of tough, you know, when you make it to the big club, going back to 2010, then you go back down, then you go back up. He's kind of been a yo-yo the last couple of years. Grounder to short. Pastrnicki on target with this throw for the second out of the inning. When you look at it, though, Mike Miner is a guy who's always had big league stuff, former first-round pick of the Braves.
Talk about the pressure, Tyler Pastrnicki. One thing that the Braves love about him is he can play great defense. He looks relaxed. He has a strong arm and pretty good range.
Miller, the center fielder, takes strike one. Miner valuable in a couple of ways for the Braves this year. Obviously, the great stuff that he has, the experience now over the last couple of years, and he's the only left-hander in the rotation.
And I think that's very important for the Braves rotation to have that lefty, you know, right in the middle of that starting rotation, because to me in the playoffs it matters. Not so much during a year if you have right-handers who can really get left-handers out, but to me you have to mix it up in the playoffs.
Now three balls and a strike, make it 3-2.
And I have the count of 2-2. Yep.
Fouled away. Spring training for the scoreboard operator as well. I got it fixed now.
Everybody's working the kinks out right now.
Deuce is wild on Miller. Swing and a miss, strike three. Miner gets that one over at 87 miles an hour and looking sharp here through two. We go to the bottom half of the second, no score. second about to unfold. Get all the latest spring training information at css-sports.com and enter for a chance to win a trip for four to Florida, presented by Visit Florida. Visit our spring training page at css-sports.com. Ugla, Jones, and Freeman as Jason Hamill goes to work on the middle of the order. Dan Ugla, a home run in his last three spring training games. Even the balls he's hitting for outs, Brian, he is smoking the ball right now.
He is. He's right on everything, and that's a great sign to be on that fastball this early in spring training.
Can't hold up there.
Nasty slider by Hamill. Good break on that ball.
Ugla, the quickest second baseman in Major League history to reach 100 home runs. And that catches the outside corner. Ugla goes down backward K style.
Big curveball by Hammond. Kind of stunned Ugla. This is a curveball coming from a 6'6 guy. Good break, breaking away off the corner of the plate. That's one way you just spit on it. You know, you look, you just say, hey, I got him next time.
Chipper Jones smokes one down the left field line, and that's a fair ball. And it'll bang around in the corner. Chipper will coast into second with a one-out double.
A good piece of hitting by Chipper. Chipper on deck watching the fastball. You saw how Hamill just started him out. Started all the hitters off with a fastball up in the zone, and Chipper gets a fastball away and just slaps it down the line. So used to seeing Chipper doing that. He knows when to swing hard and when to just slap the ball.
Now here's a guy that can hit it well to all fields. Freddie Freeman, what a terrific rookie campaign Freeman had last year. If it wasn't for some guy named Craig Kimbrell, might have been the rookie of the year.
Exactly. But it was just great to see both of those guys in the running. Freddie's one of those guys you'd love to talk to. He's always smiling, just happy to be out at the ball field. A great hitter.
Off the pitcher's glove towards second. Antonelli is there in a weird 1-4-3 out that advances Chipper to third.
I'll give Freddie Freeman a lot of credit. He knew what he was doing, trying to go up the middle, driving a run, and good play by Hamill to slap that ball and knock it down. And this ball's hit hard. And good reaction by Toninelli over there, second base.
Now Jordan Peraz. Peraz showed up. Nobody was really expecting a whole lot, at least not from a fan standpoint. Most people probably looked at that name and said, well, who is this guy? Well, he's been in the Yankees organization. We saw him last year doing a Gwinnett Braves broadcast, the AAA affiliate. He was playing for Scranton Wilkes-Barre. Had a solid year in AAA, but certainly not numbers that would jump off the page.
Had nine home runs. He hit .289. Pretty good player, but he's opening some eyes here in Atlanta camp.
Hitting .421.
Very aggressive hitter.
0-2 pitch into right field, a base hit, and a run will score. Chipper touches home. Peraza's great spring continues, and the Braves are on the board. It's 1-0.
Speaking of aggressive hitter, he swung at every pitch Hamill threw, and he finally hits a line drive to right field. Stayed back, got a fastball away. Put some wood on that ball. Got on top of it.
Eighth man of the order is Tyler Pastrnicki. Pastrnicki has struggled this spring, hitting .139. He's stung the ball pretty well the last couple of days. And again, he's found himself in a pretty strong battle with the young man, Andrelton Simmons.
chance to talk to Greg Walker, Braves hitting instructor, hitting coach. And he's saying Tyler's finally starting to relax a little bit. He's been pressing so badly early in spring training. He's starting to, you know, use his hands and be the Tyler Pastrnicki we saw in Gwinnett, right? Because that last month last year, I think both of us were really impressed with this young man.
Nobody could get him out. He's got good speed once he gets on the bases as well. Runner goes. Pitches a strike. The throw down in time. Bang, bang play at second. And Jeff Nelson says the tag got him. So the side is retired, but the Braves on the board. An RBI single by Peraz scores Chipper Jones. We move on to the third, 1-0 Braves. Buy a ticket plan and receive 33% off food and beverages at Turner Field. Go to Braves.com/tickets or call 404-577-9100 to purchase your season ticket package today. That's a strong deal right there.
33% off your food? Wow.
I like that. It's just one more excuse to grab a couple more hot dogs.
Put on a couple more pounds.
Sure. That's what it's all about at the ballpark. First pitch is upstairs to the eighth man in the order, L.J. Hose. As you might have noticed, a lot of Orioles with those high numbers. You got a lot of non-roster invitees, a lot of minor leaguers in the lineup today. The Orioles have a split squad. The regular lineup features guys like Ryan Roberts, Nick Markakis, Mark Reynolds, and Adam Jones, who was rumored to be a possible traded player to the Braves in this offseason.
I like Adam Jones. He's a terrific player. Great defensive player. Has power.
1-2 pitch buckled him. Strike three. The second strikeout for Mike Minor.
After the last swing on the changeup, Mike Minor comes back with that fastball on the outer half for the plate. All he could do is look at it. Like the way Mike is changing speeds.
First pitch, a strike to Machado. Machado batting 125. Lofting this one to deep center. Born on his horse, now slowing up. And puts it away for out number two. Mike Minor, as we mentioned, expected to be in that starting rotation. Tim Hudson, who might miss the first month of the season coming off the back injury. Jurgens, Hansen, Beachy, who just continues to look better and better every time out. And Mike Minor, pretty solid five right there, Brian Jordan.
It is pretty solid five. And then you got Tayron and Delgado, who's battling for that fifth spot right now with Tim Hudson, who's going to miss probably the first month of the season. I mean, you got a plethora of pitches out there, not just in the starting rotation, but in the bullpen too.
Brian breaking up the big words already in spring training. You're in mid-season form.
Oh, man. This is spring training for me, too. I'm trying to get it right, get it prepared.
I thought you'd wait till opening day to throw out the thesaurus. My goodness.
Yeah, I've been working hard this offseason.
One ball, one strike. Off the plate outside. Of course, the name that you didn't see on that list, in addition to Tayron and Delgado, Chris Medlin, who's had a very good spring and is always good for a spot start.
And that's one that the Braves, they know they have in their back pocket as a starter or a bullpen guy.
A soft liner with some English on it to second for out number three. Mike Minor looking very good so far. Middle of the third, Braves one, Orioles nothing. Nothing. Bottom of the third, about to get underway. It'll be Pastrnicki, Boscan, and Bourne. Braves already with two hits, including an RBI single to right by Jordan Peraz. Chipper Jones plating the only run of the game thus far. Both these teams would like to finish off spring training in a hot way. They have both started off rather cold, as has been well documented. We'll have more on that in a moment. The significance or lack thereof of spring training records, but certainly a lot of players like the one at the plate right now would like to finish up strong. Pastrnicki eyes a fastball away. 95 miles per hour from Jason Hamill, who's been around the block. He actually started a playoff game back in 2009 against the Phillies, the eventual world champs, and he lost that outing, but career record of 34-45.
Good to see Tyler get off to a good start of the day, get a base hit under his belt, relax a little bit. Like I said, this guy's one that can steal bases, has really good speed.
He came over in the Yunel Escobar deal, and it was almost an afterthought because obviously everybody was excited about getting Alex Gonzalez, who has since moved on. But this guy just kept rifling through the minor leagues, tore it up in Double-A Mississippi, where he was the player of the year. And then the month or so we saw him in Gwinnett, nobody could get him out. High and tight. Full count.
When we saw him in Gwinnett, he did everything right. He put the ball in play. He didn't strike out much. He was a tough strikeout. Very consistent at the plate as far as short swing.
Chopped to short. Easy play for Machado. Fans, keep up to date with everything CSS. Interact with our hosts on Twitter or Facebook. And for current schedules, program information, and the latest Hot Topic blogs, visit our website, css-sports.com. The easiest way to find out what's going on at CSS. You can tweet Brian and I, Morgan on air, and at 2SportMan. Great action photo of Brian Jordan if you visit his Twitter account. Slicer out of play off the bat of J.C. Boscon, who's been in this organization for the better part of a decade. He's had a few cups of coffee with the big club. Terrific backstop, but like a lot of catchers, still trying to improve at the plate.
And I talked to Greg Walker about J.C. Boscon, and he really likes the adjustments that he's made in spring training so far. He's starting to relax a little bit and use his hands more and not his body. And we saw him last year. You know, he started out the season with an open stance, and then he kind of closed it back up. And I think Greg Walker finally convinced him to keep that closed stance and use his hands. And now he's starting to catch up with that fastball and look more relaxed at the plate. Greg Walker still thinks he can be a pretty good hitting catcher at the big league level.
Great clubhouse guy. Pitchers love working with him. Actually was a quarterback in high school.
Wow, I did not know that.
Good athlete.
And I've talked to him all the time. I didn't know he was a quarterback. Wow.
Got to dig deep for those extra nuggets.
You dug really deep for that one.
I was like Mike Wallace of 60 Minutes when I unearthed that little piece of information. 0-2, low and away. Boscon with Michael Bourne waiting on deck. Braves last season, middle of the road for the most part at the plate. Surprisingly, though, eighth in home runs. I think a lot of people, you would have stumped on that trivia question. The Braves finished with 177 home runs, the eighth highest total in all of Major League Baseball.
You look at what Dan Uglin did, and Freeman had a pretty good power production. Brian McCann.
Boscon frozen for strike three. Well, you think if Jason Hayward, who's not playing today, but obviously continues to be a focal point of this spring, if he bounces back, it's a lot more homers in the bank.
These guys stay healthy and reach their potential. I think the Braves will be right there. J.C. Boscon looked like he just froze. He was expecting an off-speed pitch, and he got that fastball.
Michael Bourne looks at a strike. He was a strikeout victim his first time up. Bourne's still a young guy. He's only got 5 years of major league service, and already 234 stolen bases in his career. Most of those coming with Houston.
Let's hit that. Hamill started him off with two off-speed pitches, two curveballs. Comes back with a high fastball.
1-2 from the righty, and again, Michael Bourne has no answer for Jason Hamill, who's pitched pretty well in his own right. Hamill now with four punch-outs, and the Braves go down quietly in order in the third. Out of the fourth we go. Braves on top, 1-0. Florida, Champion Stadium, the Braves on top by a score of 1-0. Mike Morgan alongside former Atlanta Brave, Brian Jordan. The Braves looking for their sixth win of the spring. Struggling at the plate a little bit with Jason Hamill. Mike Miner has been outstanding thus far on the mound for the Bravos. He's yet to allow a run now in 12 innings in spring training, so you couldn't ask for much more out of the left-hander. He'll be facing Tolleson, Johnson, and Bettemann. 2-3-4 in the Baltimore lineup.
Well, Mike he's looked fantastic all spring training, but he's been going strike one, and he's very efficient with his pitches. Not throwing a lot of pitches in each inning. Going right at hitters, hitting his spots. And again, that comes with maturing. That comes with getting that confidence, trusting his stuff.
Well, you've got two guys right now that are familiar with one another. Steven Tolleson was a standout at South Carolina and faced Mike Miner at Vanderbilt in college. As Tolleson hammers that one foul. A lot of SEC guys that you'll see throughout Major League Baseball. Tolleson, a guy who started his career in the Oakland Athletics organization. And trying to make the big club here in Baltimore. 1-1 pitch, swing and a miss.
It's a really nice changeup by Mike Miner. Took a lot off that pitch. Tolleson out in front.
One, two, hit on the ground, foul. We are pleased to be joined in the booth by a name very familiar to Braves fans, now the president of the organization, John Schierholz. John, how are you?
Ryan Jordan, so I'm feeling pretty good about that. That's not ordinarily the case. Of course, I'm not taller than anybody, but that's okay.
Well, how's the spring been treating you thus far?
Well, great. I mean, no bone bruises for me, no blisters. Watching the team train, seeing them come together, play better baseball, especially the last three, four games, and like what we see.
John, you've been in, what, 46 spring trainings? You got to be impressed with what you see in Mike Miner. I mean, he looks like he's matured, and he's being very efficient this year. He looks relaxed and confident.
Yeah, he had a lot of confidence coming into camp, as I think we all know and read, and he's demonstrated that every time out. And there he goes again with another fine pitch. And he's really looks like he's made the breakthrough to be what you have to be as a major league pitcher. You know, have the stuff, but have the belief in yourself and have the consistency, and he's shown that.
It's got to be exciting for you because you've watched these young guys, these heralded pitchers that we've been talking about for a number of years, but now it's not about potential anymore. These guys are big league ready, or in the case of Mike Miner, I mean, he's a full-fledged big leaguer. He's going to be in the rotation.
Well, he's certainly got a shot at that, and we're an organization, as you know, you guys both know, we believe that homegrown players are better than not, and he and many of the other young pitchers here came up through our system, and we know what they're like, we know what their makeups are, we know what their work ethic is, and we know what we can expect from them. And we feel good about that. So it gives us a lot of comfort to have guys like Miner and Delgado and Tehran and other young pitchers in the pipeline.
Yeah, I like what you see in Dan Uglin this spring. I mean, last year, we know he got off to a slow start, but, you know, in reports, he's been very aggressive this spring, kind of learning from Chipper and Brian McCann. But I know I feel good about watching what he's doing in spring.
Yeah, you're right. I mean, offensively, he's right on top of his game, I think. I mean, he, you know, took a pitch first inning, but, you know, who doesn't? But he's shown that aggressiveness you talked to about, Brian, and obviously the power is built in. He, for some reason, he didn't think his Popeye forearms were big enough this winter, so he made them even bigger before he came into spring training, and so balls go even further over the fence. But he's done a good job, to your point.
2-2 the count to the veteran Nick Johnson. Miner, who is not allowed an earned run all spring, looking very sharp again today. And that one doesn't miss by much. John, has there been a change in philosophy within the organization? I know years ago the word on the Braves was they don't like to draft college pitchers, mainly high school guys or overseas guys. But you see Mike Miner now out of Vanderbilt. You see Sean Gilmartin out of Florida State, a first-round pick. Has that philosophy changed somewhat?
It has. I mean, you know, our eyes are open to the changing world of amateur baseball. We were always a high school oriented drafting team. We preferred to get guys young, raw material, and develop it ourselves, mold it ourselves. Now, the cost of signing high school players, quite honestly, has risen. The opportunity to go to better college programs that now exist, that didn't always exist before to the extent it does today, is there for them. So we have to look at with greater interest at college guys than we have.
Base hit off the bat of Bettemann. Two on, one out as Mike Miner finds himself in the first jam of the game thus far.
John, you were able to, I would say, watch three of the greatest pitchers pitch on the mound. Do you see, with the Braves drafting so many pitchers now, do you see ever the Braves having a combination like that again?
It would be presumptuous of me to say that any of these young guys, as talented as they are and the potential that they have, could rival that triumvirate, if you will, of Maddox, Glavine, and Smoltz, and Avery, and Merker, and all those guys. But those three guys, principally, you mentioned. You know, I hope they can. I mean, that's every team president and general manager's hope, and every owner's hope, to see guys develop like that. But if they just become qualified, capable major leaguers, that'll be good enough.
Hot shot to Jones, over to first to one. And on the first for the double play, 5-4-3, twin killing, ends the Orioles' fourth. John, certainly appreciate the time. Always good to catch up with you.
My pleasure. I love these quick innings. Just bring me over anytime.
1-0 Braves on top. Fans, get your tickets today for the Braves All-Stars versus the Future Stars game on April the 3rd at Couray Field. Come see manager Freddie Gonzalez and the Braves take on former Braves skipper Bobby Cox and the team's brightest prospects. For tickets, go to Braves.com/Future Stars or call 678-277-0340. Brian and I will be at that game broadcasting it on CSS. Look forward to seeing you there at Couray Field if you haven't already ventured on over to Gwinnett County. Caught a game there. It's a beautiful ballpark and great spot to take in a game throughout the season. That should be a lot of fun.
Oh, it's going to be a lot of fun. I had a chance to talk to Bobby Cox early today, and Bobby looked at me. I said, hey, you ready to manage again? And he's excited.
Votto, sinking line drive to center, will drop in for a base hit. That ball really had a lot of anguish on it. Miller could not come up with it.
A good effort by John Miller. Running in hard. Good diving effort to hold on to the ball. These balls are really tough to track when you got the bright sky. And it looks like Prado hit that ball a lot harder than he really did. So not a good jump out there, but great effort.
Martin Prado leading the Grapefruit League now with 15 hits. The batting average starting to flirt with 400, so he's off to a good start in spring training, as well as Brian McCann, who takes a strike.
finish up what I was saying about Bobby. I said, Bobby, you ready to manage? And he looked at me and said, hey, you want to be one of my coaches? And, you know, it was such an honor for him to even say that. I said, Bobby, I got to broadcast right. that game. I'll be in the booth talking about you. But, man, I would have loved to coach under Bobby Cox.
I would have been impressed if you could have done both. That might have been a first. McCann hitting 308 this spring. One ball, one strike to count on the Atlanta catcher. Last year, McCann leading all National League catchers with 24 home runs. McCann, one of the leaders on this team. No doubt Brian McCann felt that September swoon as badly as anybody. Here's Brian McCann talking about last season.
As a collective group, there wasn't one player it was like a collective group. It was all of us. And, I can speak for myself. I did a lot of soul searching this offseason, and that'll never happen again. I mean, I can go say that. You learn from it, you move on, and you learn from your mistakes and try to get better.
And that's really the sentiment around the Braves clubhouse. Maybe even use that as a little extra motivation for this year. If you can turn a negative into a positive, that would certainly be the way to do it.
No question, and you have to have that approach as a player because, you know, it was a terrible collapse last year, something that you don't expect as a player, but it happens. You know, you look at the Braves, you look at Boston Red Sox last year. I mean, that was two dreadful Septembers for both teams. And as a player, I mean, as a competitor, you want to come back and motivate yourself off of that.
Runner breaks, and out by a country mile is Martin Prado, the throw on the money by Paulino.
Paulino had a chance to play for Freddy Gonzalez in Miami, so Freddy should know this catcher has a bazooka arm. A perfect throw down a second. Prado got a pretty good jump. And Paulino, one step release. Not even close.
Paulino's been in this league for a while, and one of the reasons he's been able to hang on as long as he has is that arm. A little pop up in the infield, put away by Tolleson for out number two.
He got deep into Brian McCann's kitchen on that one. Those are the swings you expect in spring training. You're not catching up with that fastball. Now pitchers have that little cutter at the last second. A lot of broken backs in spring training.
First pitch to Ugla hits him. And Dan Ugla will meander to first with two away. Fans, a reminder that today's Braves spring training game is brought to you by VisitFlorida.com. Unleash your Florida side at VisitFlorida.com. Chipper Jones doubled and scored back in the second.
Chance to talk to Chipper early today and was teasing him about comments and the articles we read in the paper about him could retire tomorrow and body, his knee not feeling good, and you know, he kind of chuckled, and you know, he looks in great shape, and he said he's in great shape and he's looking forward to having a big season. He's excited about the season. That's a good sign for the fans in Atlanta to see him out there for at least 125, 130 games. I mean, if he can do that, I think the Braves are in a good situation.
And I think that's the realistic number, 125, 130 games. And, you know, Chipper, like anybody else, has his critics. But if you look at what he did in those 130 games or so and stack it up to other third baseman of the National League, he's right up there, top five in most of the major categories. was Chipper Jones talking about his all-time marks with the Braves. Third all-time in Atlanta history in home runs. Second in RBIs. Lifetime 304 hitter, which is third best. What impresses me the most about that 304 number, he's hitting 300 lifetime from both sides of the plate.
Yeah, that's real impressive.
That's extremely rare. You look at some of the best switch hitters in the history of the game, and very few of them have been able to accomplish that.
I think he's surpassed everybody as far as switch hitters. Eddie Murray probably being the best, and Chipper is overtaking him, I believe, in home runs.
2-2 pitch, cut on and missed. Chipper goes down, flailing away. And an off-speed pitch from Hamill. The Braves unable to cash in. We move to the fifth. Atlanta still on top, 1-0. Experiment presented by Visit Florida on CSS-sports.com. You can enter to win a trip to Florida simply by telling us who you think will be the last four teams standing. Vote for your favorite bracketologists as they experience the highs and the lows of tournament action. It's all on CSS-sports.com. Pitcher's duel thus far. Braves on top of the Orioles 1-0 as we're set to go in the top of the fifth. And a bunt dropped down by Beerer and nicely fielded by Mike Miner, who's in for inning number five and has still yet to allow an earned run in spring training. When I mentioned that stat talking to some of the guys in the field, you thought I put the jinx on. I had enough confidence in Mike Miner that he would still be able to do it.
You know what? I thought you put the jinx on him. You know, it's just one of those bad luck things when you mention a guy's streak, whether it's scoreless innings, hitting streak. You just don't want to hear it. And I know as a player, I didn't want to hear it.
This will be pitch number 50 from the left-hander. Mike Miner slated to be in the rotation. He would be the one left-hander. And the other battle going on right now this spring, again with Tim Hudson on the shelf in April, somebody's going to have to be called upon to get some starts to fill in for him. You got a great race between Tehran, Delgado, and you can't rule out Chris Medlin.
No, you definitely can't rule out Chris Medlin, who threw four scoreless innings yesterday in the game versus the Mets.
Faster, Nicky. Easy money to first.
And he continues to impress even as a starter. He's one of those guys that I heard in the interview, he's saying, look, I just want to help this team win, which is the politically correct thing to say. And he gives you those options. Freddie Gonzalez, I mean, he could be a spot starter, or he could be that long relief guy. And the two young guns, Tehran and Delgado, also throwing well. They started out a little cold in Detroit with the wind blowing out 100 miles an hour. So, you know, I kind of dismissed that start.
Right.
And they kind of bounced back pretty good. But they're still learning. I mean, this is a spring training for these guys to learn how to, you know, pace themselves. And each start that they have where you got to add that extra inning, it seems like they struggle in that extra inning that you add. And that's a learning process for both of those guys.
Just off the outside corner. Boscon framed it nicely. Tapper. Miner is there. Some good PFP practice for Mike Miner, who continues to be in control. Halfway home here from Orlando, the Braves 1, the Orioles nothing. Not happy with what he's seen thus far out of his starting pitcher, Mike Miner, who has not allowed a run in five innings. He's thrown 56 pitches. He's been incredibly economical and dominating thus far. Now we'll see if the Braves lineup can pick it up with Freeman, Peraz, and Pastrnicki, 6-7-8 in the Atlanta lineup. The Braves held at just three hits thus far by the man on the mound, Jason Hamill.
Jason Hamill has been pretty impressive. Changing speeds, throwing a lot of curveballs, sliders in the dirt.
Freddie Freeman, who had that great rookie season, just watching him take BP and looking at him, he just looks bigger. And I asked him about it. He said, no, I'm the same weight. I'm just stronger.
Well, he had a chance to work out with Chipper and Brian McCann this offseason.
Swinging on 3-0 and offering it in the left field for a base hit.
And he said that really helped him out this offseason. He's a lot stronger. A lot of muscle was built.
What's the feature we're going to have for you throughout our broadcast here on CSS? We're going to take you to the Wayback Machine, starting opening day lineups for various years. We're going back to 1966, the first year in Atlanta. Felipe Alou, Eddie Matthews, Hank Aaron, Cardi, Torrey. Look at some of the names on that lineup.
Rico, Cardi, Joe Torrey, catcher. Man, that's an impressive lineup. Wow.
Of course, that was the first year in Atlanta. Our own producer, Steve Graham, who's been around the block for a while. He was a Jacksonville resident. Got in the car with Pops and drove to the first ever game in Atlanta. I think a lot of people can share that kind of story. Whether it was 1966 or another year, people from around the Southeast, the Braves have really been the team of the South for decades now.
Steve Graham has a lot of history behind him, man. He's been at a lot of firsts in his lifetime.
He covered the dead ball era back when Home Run Baker was leading the league with eight bombs.
The dead ball era. Wow.
Steve Graham was there with a Polaroid. At least they different version of Sutch. Pitch popped up and caught in foul ground off the bat of Peraz. Yes. Actually, it was a cave painting. I stand corrected. It wasn't anything even resembling a picture. It was just a cave painting back when Steve was producing games. One gone for Pastrnicki.
Pastrnicki, last at bat, hit the ball hard to shortstop. See if he can find a hole this at bat.
Freeman off the bag at first. And the pitch high and tight. I can't tell you who's going to be the starting shortstop yet. That's what this next two-week period is all about. But we can tell you whoever it is, they're going to be in the eight hole. Whether it's Pastrnicki or Simmons. Saw Jack Wilson today. He looked pretty good. They're now saying that Jack Wilson might be back sooner than expected.
Well, I talked to him early. He's going over to the backfield to work out.
Pastrnicki down the line. Foul.
He's going out to one of those backfields to work out. He said he's feeling a lot better, and he's close to getting back in the lineup. And you really can't count him out as the starting shortstop. I know going into spring training, it was Tyler Pastrnicki's to lose, really. And the kid Simmons has opened up a lot of eyes, but you know, your safety net, and this is the reason why they signed Jack Wilson back, because he can play the shortstop. He can be your everyday shortstop.
And he can teach these young guys, whoever it is, be it Simmons or Pastrnicki. 1-1 pitch, Freeman on the go, hit and run. That'll keep him out of the double play as Pastrnicki is retired. Two gone with a runner in scoring position.
Again, I said Pastrnicki. He put the ball in play, saw the hit and run there, and made contact. Couldn't find that hole. Shorten up his swing and pitch away from him. Fought to put it in play, but he did his job. See if J.C. Boscon can do his job by driving in Freeman from second base.
Corey Guerin warming up in the Atlanta bullpen. Breaking ball misses low and away. There you see Guerin, who's been back and forth between AAA and the big club. Fastball high.
Buck Showalter, you got to be happy with what you've seen in Jason Hamill. He's really pitched a good game so far.
Two and one.
Good swing by JC. Just missing that fastball. After watching JC last year in Gwinnett, I've never seen him take aggressive swings like that, where he stays balanced. So I can tell the difference Greg Walker has put on his swing.
Greg Walker is a name you're going to hear a lot of this year. Greg Walker and Scott Fletcher. It's kind of a unique dynamic duo. Greg Walker told me that he insisted he wanted to have another guy to work with. He's always had that setup, somebody who can analyze video, and it's really kind of a tag team effort with both of those guys, former major league hitters, working with hitters for the Braves now.
And it's not a bad thing. When you look at the last couple of years for the Atlanta Braves, offensively, they've struggled. Overall average, especially in situations where you need to put the ball in play. We've seen the Braves not get it done down the stretch. Last year was one, and the year before that.
Well, the Braves would love to take some pressure off of this bullpen, which might have been a little bit taxed at the end of the year.
Man.
And that comes with playing in so many low-scoring one-run games, extra-inning games. Payoff pitch to Boscan, and we'll do it again. And that's something Freddie Gonzalez talked about. You know, we don't need to be in 55 one-run games like we were a year ago. I'd like to get some cushion where you don't have to continually use Venters, O'Flaherty, right, and Kimbrel.
And he took a lot of heat for that last year, which I felt like it was unfair because, I mean, what are you to do when it's one run and you got your best guys in the bullpen, right, and you're forced to use them, and then you got young guys forced into duty at the end of the season.
Nice at bat for Boscan.
Great at bat. And at the end of the season, you're forced to use these guys, and you force these young guys to only pitch five innings, and now all of a sudden your bullpen is taxed at the end of the year.
Well, and think about it. 55 one-run games, 26 extra-inning games. You would think those totals would be lower in 2012. That's going to do it for Jason Hamill. Pitched very well. Might have run out of gas here in the fifth. The Braves threatening and leading it 1-0. Orioles is Chris Petrini, number 93, as we look at Jason Hamill's line for today. Very impressive. Five strikeouts and 4 2/3. Allowed four hits, one walk, and one earned run. And of course, he's responsible for the two on base right now for Atlanta. Braves will have Michael Bourne at the plate with two on and two outs against this left-hander.
Hamill throwing 73 pitches, 46 for strikes. It's a good day's work for Jason Hamill. See if Michael Bourne can do some damage. 0 for 2, two strikeouts. First at bat, strikeout swinging. And the second at bat, looked at a slot on the outer half of the plate. It was a cold strike three.
And had a few choice words for home plate umpire
yes,
Jerry Lane.
Yes, he did. Who said you're not competitive in spring training?
Yeah. First pitch of ball to Michael Bourne. 5'11", 180 pounds from Houston, Texas. Acquired by the Braves from the Astros last year in that exchange for outfielder Jordan Schaefer, along with Juan Abreu, a couple other minor leaguers. Michael Bourne is signed through the end of this season, then he'll be a free agent, and there will no doubt be plenty of suitors for Michael Bourne's services.
Hopefully the Braves can get something done with this kid. I would love to see him sign with the Braves long term. That leadoff hitter the Braves haven't had in a long time since Rafael Furcal.
Yeah, it's been a trouble spot over the last 5 or 6 years. Bourne behind on the count, 1-2 pitch. Swing and a miss, not even close on that one. The breaking ball has given him fits today. A hat trick now for Michael Bourne. But the Braves strand two. At the end of five, Atlanta leads it 1-0. for opening day on April the 13th, presented by PNC Bank. Take in the opening day festivities and stay for Friday night fireworks presented by Publix. Tickets are on sale now at Braves.com/tickets or by calling 1-800-745-3000. One of my favorite days of the year. And no doubt it'll be a great crowd once again at Turner Field. Braves and Brewers going at it at the home opener in Atlanta. New pitcher for the Braves is Corey Gearin. Corey Gearin last year threw in 18 games for the big club. He has spent most of the last 2 years at AAA Gwinnett. The numbers from last year are very misleading. He had one of those blow-up appearances where nothing went right, had to take one for the team and stay out there. And that inflated the ERA to 7.85. But he proved last year, Gearin did, that he can pitch at the major league level.
No question about it. One of those three-quarter sidearm guys. Was in the mid-90s. But the fact that he throws the sidearm, it's tough on those right-hand hitters.
Kind of guy you used to hate to face,
oh,
right?
Oh, my goodness. I could not stand seeing one of those sidearmers out there on the mound.
Machado takes inside. He flied out to center his first time up.
Look at the loss of Peter Moreland, who signed a minor league deal. He's rehabbing. They really need that sidearm guy, because if we saw how effective Peter Moreland was for the last couple of years for the Braves.
Swing and a miss. That's a very common hack that we just saw by Machado for an opposing batter against Corey Gearin. A pitch tailing away from a right-handed batter. And missing by about 6 inches. 1-2, there it is again, and that's all she wrote.
Gets you looking away, and then he throws that nasty sinker in, and here's one of those nasty sliders that just breaking away from right-hand hitters. Let's try to get up on the plate on these guys, and all of a sudden I'm breaking my bat with sinkers. So it's nothing you can do that they can't read you and make the adjustment on.
Top of the order, and Antonelli, who takes a strike. He's 0 for 2.
And that's that nasty sinker I was talking about, running back across the inside of the plate.
Gearin, a fourth round draft pick of the Braves back in 2007. He's out of Chattanooga, Tennessee. They really called him up at a time last season when they needed him. And he filled in quite nicely again, except for that one rough go of it. He was very effective. 0-2 pitch, again cued foul. But you can't say enough about Mike Minor, who's now pitched 14 innings in the spring and has yet to allow an earned run.
Totally different pitcher, very efficient, very aggressive. First pitch strikes. That's what you love to see if you're the pitching coach like Roger McDowell. And you love that about Mike Minor in spring training right now.
One ball, two strikes. Minor has pitched well. Hanson looking good. Two young guys, for the most part, I think the Braves have been happy with. 1-2 pitch. That will likely reach the seats. It will. When you talk about Tehran and Delgado, you know, the ERAs are not sparkling, but if you just look at what they've done in a vacuum in their most effective innings, they've been very sharp. They've had a couple of blow-up innings. You mentioned the Tehran game in which the wind was blowing out, gives up six home runs. But there have been signs that Tehran and Delgado are indeed ready, if called upon, to once again get some starts at the big league level.
Well, I think they proved that last year.
Right through the hole into left field for a base hit. One out single off the bat of Antonelli.
I think both of those guys proved themselves last year, pitching in really tough situations down the stretch in September in big games, and they really perform well.
Well, this is a conversation that goes on every time this year. What is the significance of a spring training record? The last 20 years, these are some of the worst records the Braves have had in the spring, and then what they've done in the regular season, and with the exception of 06, all those bad spring training records turned out to be terrific regular seasons. So I know it's said time and time again, but sometimes it's hard to convince people. The record is not what you look for in spring training.
Well, I have a radio show, 1100 the game, back in Atlanta, and nice I get plug. That every caller calls in and they're in panic mode about the Braves record right now. And I try to remind them that Bobby Cox, when he was the manager, he never cared about what the record was. He cared about getting out of spring training healthy, and guys get their timing down, they get their prep work done, and ready for opening day. That's the most important thing. Yes, you want to win, you want to get that positive vibe, but it's not a big deal.
Much more of an individual sport this time of year.
It is. And for a manager, you got to make some tough decisions. I go back to 2 years back, and we were talking about the outfielder for the Pirates that we got who struggled badly.
Nate McLaughlin.
And it was a week left in spring training, and Bobby evaluating his swing, he was overmatched. And Bobby kind of knew, you know, although his hands were tied and he had to start him out, he was going to struggle.
Right.
And we remember he struggled really bad. So it is important that guys continue to get that timing down and just work hard to get ready.
Strike at the letters to Tolleson. He goes down for the second out of the inning. Second punch out for Gearing.
It's that nasty slider, tight slider. Started out in on Tolleson and came right back across the middle of the plate.
You bring up a great example, though, of where individually spring numbers do matter. Nate McLeod, you could just see it back in 2010. He just looked overmatched, and that went right into the regular season. And really, for the most part, it never stopped with his stint in Atlanta the rest of the way.
And you know, and as a manager, you really don't look at the batting average. You look at the guy's swing. If he's on everything, he's just missing, he's fouling off, and he's hitting 100, that's okay. Mm-hmm. But if you're overmatched and you're hitting 100 and you just look like you can't hit the side of a barn with the bat, you know, it's a difference. And for Nate McLeod, the great manager Bobby Cox is, he knew it. And lo and behold, it was a terrible season for Nate McLeod.
Nate McLeod has moved on. Michael Bourne now the center fielder. When you look at it, this Atlanta team, so much has been made about what hasn't been done in the offseason, but quite frankly, they didn't really need to do a whole lot. This one sprayed in the left for a base hit. Two on now off of Corey Gearing here in the sixth.
Corey has to get the ball down in the zone. He's getting that ball, he's elevating that slider, and guys can see that pitch. For a left-hander, it's easy to slap that slider coming back at you the other way.
Now Bettement, the former Brave, one for two. He'll turn around and hit lefty against the right-hander Gearing.
Wilson has some pop. You don't want to get that ball up in the zone on Wilson Bettement.
Strike call to Bettement. Great crowd here at Champion Stadium. It seats 9,500. And more often than not, you'll be right near that capacity mark, not to mention the fans on the berm. Getting plenty of sunshine today. I ran into a bunch of people at dinner the other night that drove down from Virginia. And they all have their Washington National jerseys on. And I said, you know, what are you guys What are you guys doing? What are you here for? We just decided to take a week off. The Colt caravan came down. We're going to take in. We're going to follow the Nationals. They were here for the game against the Braves. They go to Port St. Lucie for the game against the Mets. And just one stop after the other. And so many baseball fans, not just Braves fans, do that. What a great trip.
It's just a great vacation that families plan ahead of time and just enjoy. Enjoy traveling, seeing different sites here in Florida. But cheering for their team. And I'm quite sure they're excited about the Nationals' new-look team.
This is a mile-high pop-up. Jones on the pitcher's mound hauls it in for out number three. So Guerin gets out of the jam. Side retired. Orioles unable to play to run. Middle of the sixth. Braves still leading it 1-0. Free Braves open house on March the 31st. Fans will be able to enjoy free Scouts Alley games, clubhouse tours, and kids run the bases. The Braves will also host a Waffle House charity breakfast served by Braves alumni. Go to Braves.com open house for more details. Alongside former Atlanta Brave Brian Jordan, I'm Mike Morgan. Great to be with you here at Champion Stadium on a beautiful Sunday afternoon. In Central Florida, pitcher's duel thus far. Mike Minor, if you're just joining us, fared very well. Five scoreless innings. And speaking of which, Mike Minor, the left-hander, will join us now. Mike, first of all, congratulations. Another great outing. You've yet to surrender a run in the spring. Obviously, you got to feel pretty good about your performance thus far.
Yeah, it feels good. Just getting out there and then working in five innings feels like a complete start now. And really starting to throw some breaking pitches in there and working hitters to where you want to be, you know, when the season starts.
Mike, what's been the big difference? I mean, you look relaxed out there. You're more efficient. You're very aggressive early in the count. What has been the difference coming in to this spring training?
Like I've said, you know, all along is the curveball, the breaking ball. And today it was feeling really good, but I was throwing a lot of two-strike, you know, in the dirt breaking balls, and I got a couple swings, luckily. But I also had a couple that just first pitch, you know, snuck in there for a first pitch strike, and that's big when you're trying to get hitters out, is to sneak that first pitch strike in there, and then, you know, work the changeup and fastball away, fastball in, try to work both sides of the plate, and today it was a big step for me.
Mike, how valuable have those starts in Atlanta the last couple of years? I know maybe not as many as you would like, but certainly enough where you feel more comfortable this year as a guy slated for the rotation.
Yeah, last year was just a stepping stone of you know, getting out there and trying to get the team to have confidence in me of being that fifth guy maybe this year and try to just, you know, keep the team in the game and not let anybody score.
You look more relaxed, like the pressure's off. I mean, is that your attitude? The pressure's off that you're going to be the number five guy and you don't have to go out there and prove anymore.
There's still that fire in me that I have to prove something every time I go out there. But I feel like this year I have more of a direction where I'm going, and it's not set in stone, but I feel like they're looking at me as the fifth guy and trying to help the team out right away and make the team. But just like last year, I had a fight for my spot, and I feel like I still got to do that this year just to prove something. And got a lot of guys, behind me that, Teron and Delgado and those guys that are creeping up. So I can't really relax or take a day off.
Well, Mike, so far so good in the sprint. We wish you the best of luck the rest of the way, and we'll see you throughout the regular season.
All right, thanks, guys.
All right, good luck, man.
Mike Miner joining us after another flawless performance today. Mike Miner really having the best spring of any of the Braves pitchers thus far. Prado striking out against the new Orioles pitcher, Tsuyoshi Wada. Brian, you're going to have a lot of fun with this name.
You know what? I'm going to call him his nickname, Dr. K. That's what they called him in college.
He's born in Japan. He still resides in Fukuoka, Japan. Boy, you better be careful when you say that one fast. He was signed by the Orioles as a non-drafted free agent to a 2-year contract. And, of course, as you can see, he is a left-hander.
Well, he has to be pretty nasty the way he struck out Prado. Prado was way out in front. He has that deceiving motion, coming from a lefty. And you see a lot of Japanese pitchers. They have that hesitation, that motion, that deceiving motion to try to get hitters off track. And if you're seeing him for the first time like Prado was, he was way out in front because he has that little hesitation before you can see the ball come out of his hand.
You watch him wind and throw, and I feel like I'm looking at a left-handed Nomo.
Exactly. That's a great comparison. He has a change-up motion, but then a 92-mile-an-hour fastball comes out of that hand.
And nice with the glove right there. Robbing Brian McCann of a base hit. Two up, two down as Dan Uggla enters the batter's box. We talked about the struggles in the first half of the year for Dan Uggla. Here's Dan Uggla talking
about it. It was unfortunate that I got off to such a slow start, but, I believe everything happens for a reason. Who's to say I would have did what I did in the second half and if that hadn't happened. But it did happen, and I bounced back from it and was able to help my team out, a lot in the second half. But no rhyme or reason for it. It's just one of those things.
It had to be one of the most bizarre seasons I've ever seen, Brian. A guy that absolutely tears it up in the second half, finishes with incredible power numbers. A guy that has the lowest batting average of any regular in Major League Baseball for much of the first half. A guy that then has a 33-game hitting streak. And then a guy that, when it's all said and done, you feel like had an outstanding year because of the way he finished. But you look at the batting average, and it's 233. Long story short, I don't think he's ever going to have a stretch that bad again, and I don't think he's ever going to hit 233 again, so you can expect to see better numbers from Dan Uggla in 2012.
Oh, no question about it, and he reminds me of myself when I got traded out to L.A. I got off to a horrendous start. The first 2 months I couldn't hit the side of a barn, and it was because I put added pressure on myself. I came to a new team, and I wanted to impress everybody, wanted to prove the Braves wrong of trading me, and instead of going out there and letting my talents take over, and it took me 2 months to realize that, and finally when I figured it out, I had an outstanding second half of the season. And Dan Uggla, last year when he was going through it, I was saying the same thing. Once he finds it, he was going to relax and have a great second half, and that's exactly what he did.
He finished with 33 home runs, the fifth consecutive year of 30 home runs or more. Throws none that one.
Nasty changeup.
Right around 80 miles an hour. And the Braves retired in order in the sixth on inning number 7. 1-0 our score. Good pitching in this ball game thus far. The Braves leading it 1-0. Each team with four hits. Second time Atlanta and Baltimore have met this spring training. The first time was in Sarasota. The Orioles winning that game. The Braves trying to emerge victorious today. And they'll do so with the help of a very strong bullpen. We're going to see the aces out of the pen today, including the man on the mound right now, the left-hander Eric O'Flaherty. And what a year this southpaw had in 2011. An earned run average of under one and over 70 appearances. It had never been done in the history of Major League Baseball. What more do you need to say?
You don't have to say anything. This guy got it done last year, and outside of a couple minor injuries that set him back a little bit, I mean, he was unhittable. I mean, he was what can you say? He was unbelievable. I don't think anybody can duplicate a season like that.
Well, I think it kind of snuck up on people, quite frankly, because Kimbrel and Venters were so good that people kind of forgot about how quietly this guy was mowing people down. Tricky hop for Chipper. Rifle across. I beg your pardon. That's the new third baseman, Terdasovic, who's been making a name for himself this spring training.
Speaking of names, he's really making a name for himself. Wow.
Going back to the bullpen for a moment, the Braves when leading after seven last year. First 5 months of the year, almost perfect, 60-3. But then in September, it seemed like a couple of the guys wore down a little bit, just 7-5. And there's a lot of different things you can point to about what happened in September when the Braves went 9-18 and lost hold of that wild card. But that number, as important as any of them. Two up, two down for Eric O'Flaherty. Drew Sutton is the new left fielder. Terdasovic at third. There you see Sutton battling for one of those final utility slots. Miller cuts and misses for strike one.
If you're on Flaherty, you would like to get a little more work than just four pitches. That's his fifth pitch of the inning. And it's already two outs and an 0-2 count for Mr. Ja Miller.
Eric's cursed by his own success. Swing and a miss, strike three. He'll have to get some more work some other time.
He'll have to go in the bullpen and warm up again.
Like a hot knife through butter. Goes right through the Orioles lineup. Stretch time in Central Florida. Braves 1, Orioles nothing. Braves on top.
Here, Mike was just incredible, man. He hitting his spots, and here Chipper Jones hits a double down the line, get the hit parade started. And how about Jordan Peraz? RBI single to right field, and man, that's all the scoring there is. But the pitching has been phenomenal. Corey Guerin, nice slider strikeout. Strikeout number two for Corey. And here in the seventh inning, O'Flaherty getting it done, making it look easy. Just eight pitches, three outs. What can you say? I mean, the Braves pitching is the starters and the bullpen just look incredible.
Turdasovich is going to start things off. He's now in the five hole, which has been vacated by Chipper Jones. If you have any questions for us regarding the Braves this spring training, you could always tweet us at Morgan on Air, at Two Sport Man. We'll try to get to several questions throughout this ball game and the rest of our slate here on CSS. He's Brian Jordan, in case you didn't know. World-renowned two-sport athlete. I'm merely Mike Morgan. Great to be with you today. I only wish, if you're watching this in a spot where the weather is not this good, I wish we could bring it into your living room, because it is picture perfect. That's right, we've got an HD too. So the weather, as if it wasn't good enough, in high def, it's just, it's up a couple of notches. And this guy looks so good, Brian. You're in HD. You take it up another couple notches.
Tedeschi. He looks real good. A lot of people are very impressed with this young man.
He's been one of the names that has kind of stood out. In fact, people have been forced to take notice on how you get Turdasovich out of Turdosolavich. The switch hitting corner man. He's got some pop, and he drills this one into the gap in left center field all the way to the wall. Turdasovich will coast it a second with a stand-up double.
Good start to the inning for the Braves. I'm going to call him Joey. Joey got a change up.
Joey
up.
T.
He got a change up in the zone. He stayed back well and drives this ball in the gap. Good start for the Braves. A leadoff double. Freddie Freeman with a chance to drive in a run here. No outs. At least get the job done. Pull the ball and get Joey over to third. It's late in the game. That extra run is so important. And this is a situation last year where the Braves struggled late in the game. Not putting that one run across and giving that bullpen a two-run cushion. You have to pull the ball here if you're Freddie Freeman. You definitely have to put the ball in play somehow. And that is not going to do it.
Antonelli puts the squeeze on it for out number one. Well, we talked about the 66 lineup. This one a little more contemporary. How about we take you back to 1999, the opening day lineup. Nixon, Boone, Chipper. I don't know who that guy hitting cleanup was.
Wow.
Bobby Lopez, Ryan Klesko, Jones, Walt Weiss, and Tom Glavine.
That's a pretty good-looking lineup right there.
Brian Jordan batting cleanup.
Hey, that was the year Chipper Jones won the MVP, baby. Needed that guy behind him to
protect him. Well, you were a part of some pretty historic seasons, because right before that was the McGuire year, right?
Exactly right.
And you were
another guy.
Part of many of those memories.
Another MVP there. Mark McGuire. That a way to get him over to third base. Wild pitch.
Turdasovich scampers to third. One away, and now a fly ball could tie it up. Peraz with the only run batted in today.
It's one of those nasty sinkers. Not handle.
It is scored a wild pitch. One ball, one strike, the count. Swing, miss.
Again, situation where the Braves definitely have to improve this year. Man in scoring position, you have to put the ball in play. Not afford to strike out. We've seen that too often from the Braves in the last couple of years.
Drawn in infield. Count evens up. Two balls, two strikes. Pastor Nicky waits on deck. The only run in this game coming back in the second inning, an RBI single by Peraz, scoring Chipper Jones. Ground ball foul. Peraz out of the Yankees organization. Made it as high as AAA, and now
Yoshi's keeping that ball down in the zone, trying to get Peraz to swing the ball in the dirt here.
Two-two pitch.
Sneak the fastball by. That ball was very hittable. Up in the zone. Out of half of the plate.
Ground ball. Diving stop by Machado. The throw to first in time. A run will score. Peraz robbed of a hit. A great defensive play, but the Braves get a little insurance. It's 2-0.
Well, that's a good job right there by putting the ball in play. Hit it hard, hard enough where the shortstop had to dive to the backhand. An easy run for the Braves. And Jordan continues to impress. Two RBIs on the day, the only two runs. Good at bat right there, good battle.
Now Pastrnicki. He's hit it on the ground twice to Machado with no success. I think your average Braves fan feels good about the pitching. The bullpen, I don't think there's a better bullpen in baseball than what the Braves can showcase. The offense, that's what everybody wants to know. Will there be some more runs on the board this year as you see Johnny Venters warming up for the next inning?
I think the two big question marks are going to be shortstop and Jason Heyward can return to his rookie form. But other than that, I think, you know, you have to feel good about what you're going to put out there on the field. Chipper at third and Uglett second, Freeman over at first and Prado on left, Michael Bourne and B. McCann. Only two question marks out there.
1-2 is fouled at the plate. Well, here's how I look at it. I'm a simpleton, Brian. I look at what Jason Heyward's average was last year, 227. Dan Uglas, 233. Martin Prado's, 260. All three of those guys are much better hitters than those numbers would indicate. And so from that standpoint, I would think you'd have some improvements up and down the lineup. 1-2 pitch got him swinging. Tough day at the office for Pastrnicki. He's 0 for 3, but the Braves plate an insurance run here in the seventh. We move on to the eighth. Atlanta 2, Baltimore nothing. Oh, Mejia. He'll be
and
starting.
Then you got Luis Durango in center field.
CSS is the place to go to. 80 live college baseball games featuring the top-ranked teams in the country. On Tuesday, 19th-ranked Georgia takes on 14th-ranked Georgia Tech live at 7 p.m. And next weekend, it'll be number one-ranked Florida traveling to number three-ranked South Carolina live at 7 on Friday, 1 p.m. on Saturday. It's all on CSS. Frank Wren, got a couple of boys that play for Georgia Tech. Well, he's a proud pop. Tries to watch the Yellow Jackets every opportunity he can. New pitcher for the Braves, Johnny Venters, who has been so good in 2 years with the big club. Started off as a guy they looked at as a starter, and now they have found his niche. One of the best setup men in all of baseball. Fly ball, deep right. Long run for the new center fielder, Durango, and he can't catch up to it. And a one-hop defense. A ground rule double for Ward.
Well, you see the wind blowing out to right field, and looked like that ball just ran away from Durango.
Here's that three-headed monster and what they were able to do last year. O'Flaherty, Venters, Kimbrell. Craig Kimbrell, the rookie of the year. 46 saves, just unbelievable numbers across the board. You start thinking of great bullpens with depth over the years. I can think of one that comes to mind, Brian, that goes back to your era, the Nasty Boys.
The Nasty Boys, yes, that's right.
In Cincinnati. But usually a team is lucky to have two guys that put up those kind of numbers. The Braves had three. That is so rare.
Takes me back to asking John Schuerholz about the three great starters you have. You look at the Braves now and they got three great bullpen guys.
And they're all young. I mean, that's the thing. They're all so young. Machado with a runner at second. Nobody out. Venters rifling a fastball over that time at 92 miles per hour. Of course, his money pitch is that power sinker.
From the left side.
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty nasty. He used the right hand to throwing that heavy sinker.
And a squibber. Pass Ugla at second into right field. A run will score easily. And the Orioles are on the board. It's 2-1.
Venters went away right here. Machado puts the ball in play. Good effort by Dan Ugla, but couldn't make the play. Good RBI single by Machado. Got a fastball up in the zone that he could handle. I mean, that was a good piece of hitting, man. On second base, no outs. You got to hit the ball to the right side, and Machado did just that.
There's a look at Ernesto Mejia, the first baseman, recently inserted into the game for Atlanta. Luis Durango, the new center fielder for the Braves. There's Mejia. Probably ticketed to be the starting first baseman for Gwinnett this year. One ball, one strike, the count on Antonelli, who's one out of three today. Wind finally dying down. We've had some pretty strong gusts to right for much of the day. Sometimes blowing in a bit. There's another squibber off the bat. Venter's going to have to make the play himself, and he does. One unassisted.
Well, that was the only play Venter's had. With Ernesto coming in charging. No way Ugly can get over the first base to cover there. Cat-like instincts. Venters. Machado moves over to second. RBI situation for Mr. Tolleson.
Tolleson 0 for 3. and takes a strike. Johnny Venters last year pitched in 85 games that led the major leagues.
85 games.
0-1 pitch, fly to right. Perez waits on it and puts it in the glove. And shows off the arm, almost got Machado getting a little bit greedy off the bag at second.
I'll tell you what, Jordan is showing everything. He has an arm he can hit. And this is an excellent throw through the cutoff man. Machado almost got caught off too far. Well, if you had any questions about Peraza's arm, those questions are answered.
Joseph, the pinch hitter, so Nick Johnson's day is done for the O's. Caleb Joseph. One on, two outs, and a one-run game.
Chance for this young man to open some eyes. One-run game, man on second, two outs. See if he can put in the pressure cooker here and deliver.
Tied up in knots on that swing, Jeff. Johnny Venters can do that to you.
Wow. What a nasty slider. Man, you're talking about fooling the hitter. Oh, that almost hit him in the ankle, the back ankle.
That ain't right. Fly ball to right, slicing toward the line, long run, and in and out of the glove of Perez. The tying run will score, and Joseph pulls on the brakes at second.
Wow, that has to be an error. Jordan Perez, and this is a tough play because you're running, and as your feet hitting the ground, your head is moving. You really got to focus in on that ball going right in the glove and hit off the heel of Perez's glove, and a big run for the Orioles.
That brings Jeff Larish to the plate. And unless Larish has changed things since I last saw him when he was with the Tigers, he would have the most quiet hands. He would be frozen at the plate until after the ball was released. Look at that. There's no, finally lifts the leg. A bouncer to third to Goslovich. A little bit scary on the throw, but it does get there in time for out number three. The error by Perez accounts for the tying run. 2-2 our score heading to the bottom of the eighth. The free Braves open house on March the 31st. Fans will be able to enjoy free Scouts Alley games, clubhouse tours, and kids run the bases. The Braves will also host a Waffle House charity breakfast served by the Braves alumni. Go to Braves.com/open house for more details. Alongside Brian Jordan, Mike Morgan, it's great to be with you. Here in sunny, beautiful Central Florida, the Braves playing host to the Orioles. 2-2 our score. Champion Stadium. Be with you again next week when the Braves take on the Houston Astros. New pitcher for the Orioles is Oscar Villarreal. He's been around for a while. Pitched in Atlanta a couple of seasons, then Houston.
He was pretty nasty when he was with the Braves. I remember that back in the day.
Boscan to start things off for Atlanta. Mejia's on deck. You see the numbers on Villarreal. Boscan, a strikeout and a walk. Villarreal pitched for the Braves back in 06 and 07. Bit of a workhorse in 06. He had 58 appearances. Of course, Johnny Venter's the same. That's nothing.
Really?
85, big guy. 2-1 the count.
It's been around for a while, hasn't it?
30 years old. Born in Mexico. Bouncer to second. One gone. Ernesto Mejia had a solid spring thus far. Again, likely to start the season off at AAA Gwinnett.
Big guy. I mean, the Braves have size at first base. Look at Freddie Freeman and look at this guy.
They just get bigger every year, don't they?
They do.
I'm always impressed at the smaller guys that can be such a good player. You and I had a good chance to chat with Harold Reynolds, who's in town doing some work for the MLB Network. And looking at Harold Reynolds, who's rather diminutive in stature compared to the players of today, and you're talking about a guy who was a heck of a big leaguer.
Speed guy. I still remember the play where Bo Jackson threw him out at home plate. It was an unbelievable play with Harold Reynolds' speed. And when you hear Harold talk about it, he's like, no way, when he's around the third base, could he be thrown out? And he saw the guy on deck telling him to get down, and he just couldn't believe it. That was one of the best throws I've ever seen in baseball, Bo Jackson.
One, two is high. Orioles have a guy that's kind of built like a Harold Reynolds and Brian Roberts. He's a little guy, 5'9", buck 80. But when he's healthy, and that's been an issue
that's
for Brian.
That's been a huge issue.
When he's healthy, he can be a dominating all-star player.
Switch hitting mm-hmm. Second baseman.
2-2 pitch off the plate.
He's a smaller guy with pop. Of course, you're playing in Camden Yards, but still. He has some pop from both sides, and he can run. Struggle for him to stay healthy.
You mentioned Camden Yards. Hard to believe this is the 20th anniversary. 3-2 pitch, and Mejia waves goodbye at the changeup. 20 years ago they built Camden Yards?
Wow. Jeez. Tom Fox. Slaughter from Oscar. Breaking away down in the zone. So, got to be confident to throw that 3-2.
Here's Drew Sutton. Drew Sutton's had a very good spring, hitting 348. They love his versatility. Can play him in a number of different spots. Squares, drops one down. That's a fair ball. Yeah! And that is out number three as the Braves go down in order. 1-2-3, nothing across in the eighth. We head to the ninth. Deadlock at two. SS-sports.com for comprehensive college baseball coverage, highlights, upcoming games, schedules, and much, much more, including Who's Got the Call, a weekly face-off between our web analyst Knox Bardeen and play-by-play announcer Matt Stewart as they rank the best teams in the South. Craig Kimbrell on the mound now for the Bravos. We've seen O'Flaherty, we've seen Venters, and now the third member of that great triumvirate. Craig Kimbrell, the rookie of the year, an all-star season last year. He was dominant. You knew he had a chance to be really good, but I don't know if anybody could have envisioned that dominating a year as a rookie, Brian. That's almost unheard of.
Unheard of, and especially the way he started the season. There was rumors that maybe we should put Venters in as closers because he struggled early. But his maturity, the way he handled it, the way he made adjustments, and Billy Wagner helped him a lot, you know, being his mentor. And he really worked through the problems and became a dominant closer. One of the best in the game last year.
Yeah, you and I have gotten a chance to see this guy grow up in a hurry. He was dominating at AAA Gwinnett, and before you knew it, he was the ace closer for the Atlanta Braves, racking up 46 saves. Travis Adair at the plate, his first action today.
The thing that really helped him out, though, is when the Braves brought him up and he was sort of the setup man for Billy Wagner. And he had a chance to watch how Billy Wagner approached as a closer. And you know, even Kimber will tell you how Billy Wagner is his mentor and really helped him make some adjustments and gain that confidence of that closer that you need to be successful.
And they're built the same way. Of course, Wags was a lefty, but they're both about 5'10 shorter guys for relief pitchers. You don't see a whole lot built that way. Jam job, fisted foul right near the Baltimore Orioles dugout. A Those 46 saves last year by Kimbrell, a rookie record. Ray Kimbrell, just 23 years old. Pop up behind second. And a nice play by Pastrnicki. Those type of balls are always scary. You see that triangle formulating out in the outfield. You don't know who's going to pick it up, if anybody.
Well, a great job by Tyler, just, you know, concentrating on his ball, and he was kind of just waiting to hear from the center fielder, and when he never heard from him, he made the catch. It's a dangerous play. And Durango, you almost have to call that ball because he was that close to Tyler. Outfielder always has precedence over grabbing a fly ball.
Ruttinger at the plate. Brian, when you look at this year compared to 2011, you had a couple of guys trying to prove themselves, particularly Craig Kimbrell. Now, I mean, I don't want to say they're household names, but certainly, look out. Somebody's got a souvenir in row two.
Wow. Nobody got hurt. Like a hit a lady, but she's doing fine. Wow. Well, it looks like the handle part. Oh my goodness. Oh, I can't wait to see Freddie with that reaction. That is funny.
And they do let the fan keep a bat as a souvenir, which is nice.
Usually they take it and allow the fan to pick it up after the game. Last thing you want is a fan to get angry and have that bat in hand.
Fastball high, 2-2. But just to complete the thought, now Johnny Venters with 2 years under his belt, Craig Kimbrell with 1 year under his belt, Eric O'Flaherty with a few years under his belt. All these guys have to feel more comfortable than ever, and you would think they would only become even more effective, if that's possible, here in the near future.
Well, you would hope so, and the fear there is you don't want them to get too comfortable, because, you know, when they were fighting for that spot, fighting for that position, you know, you get that added incentive. But now they're in a comfort zone, and you hope that they don't relax too much. They continue to go out there and apply themselves and put that pressure on themselves, you know, to keep them on top of their game. You know, it's tough. It's hard to be better than they were last year. There's no question about that. But they have to find a way to motivate themselves to continue that progress. Man, foul balls are flying everywhere.
I think we're next. There's a bullseye in about every quadrant of the ballpark here.
A thrown bat, now he's fouling off balls all over the place. He's trying to hurt a fan.
Payoff to Ruttinger. And just inside. Kimbrell wanted it.
The fans wanted it after trying to hurt the fans out here. It's clearly inside, down in the zone. Good call.
Now Brendan Webb, as the Orioles continue to empty the bench. 2-2 game here in the ninth. Runner on the go. Pitch gets by the catcher, and it'll easily advance the runner to second.
Might be a pass ball there. They score that.
Yeah! yards. That one foul out of play.
That's pretty impressive. Brendan Webb able to pull Kimball here in spring training midway through. He's out in front of that fastball.
In case you're wondering, they do play one inning of extra baseball here. If this is still knotted up after the bottom of the ninth. Popped up behind home plate. Wolskan looking into that sign and makes a fine grab. Two gone.
I have to keep your eyes on that fly ball. That's a ball that I thought was going to reach the stands, but it just ran right back with the wind blowing. Right back to J.C. Bolscon, who makes a good catch.
Well, this time of year, teams have about 45, 46 guys still on the roster. By the time this one's over, Baltimore might have used all of them. And another pinch hitter, Blake Davis. Mejia, soft hands at first, will take it to the bag. And the side is retired. We go to the bottom of the ninth. It's hero time. Braves and Orioles tied at two. Buy a ticket plan and receive 33% off food and beverage at Turner Field. Visit Braves.com/tickets or call 404-577-9100 to purchase your season ticket package today. We've reached the bottom of the ninth. Matt Diaz will pinch hit. Diaz back in an Atlanta uniform and things just seem right again. No offense to Pittsburgh, but I think Matty D is happy to be back in Atlanta.
No question about it. Good guys in that clubhouse, Matty Diaz.
Diaz had to battle some injuries last year. It was a season he'd like to forget. Like to get back to the form that he had for most of his young career in Atlanta, which he was a 300 hitter.
One of the best pinch hitters in the game.
...2-0 pitch. Diaz was trying to end this game with one swing of the bat. The way that wind is blowing, it's going to be tough to yank one out to left.
And that's something Matty's been working on this spring. Trying not to be a pull hitter. Found himself pulling the ball an awful lot. Trying to make that adjustment to drive the ball the other way.
That will reach the seats. Two balls, two strikes on Diaz. Constanza's on deck. Guy battling for one of those final outfield spots. If you carry five outfielders and you kind of put Hinsky in a corner man role,
You know Diaz is going to make the club. At least you certainly assume so. 2-2 pitch. Got him. Takes the corner for strike three.
Good pitch by Oscar. He kind of did that secret and ran back across the outside corner of the plate. He got enough of the plate with Jerry Lane on strike three. Good movement. He painted the corner.
Now Constanza, who became a fan favorite very quickly when he got the call up from Gwinnett to Atlanta.
Quickly made an impact. Scoring runs, using his speed. And hit a couple long balls.
This is what he does best. Ground balls, try to leg him out, but no chance there. Two outs. So Joey T. Radosavich becomes the final hope for the Braves here in the ninth. Tied up at two.
Hits a double his last at bat. Moved over on a wild pitch to third, but no one was able to drive him in.
It's a good thing Joey's got some broad shoulders.
It's a lot of letters.
0-2.
Joey pulled that front side out. He was trying to go ya-ya, trying to end this game with a walk-off.
Durango is on deck. Should Turdoslovich reach? Dusty Hughes warming up in the Atlanta bullpen. Braves have gotten everything they had hoped for on the mound today. Mike Minor, stellar in five innings of work. He's yet to allow a run. They got the big three out of the bullpen each an inning of work. Venters, O'Flaherty, and Kimbrell. Would like to see some offense. Two runs on five hits today. 2-6-0 for the Orioles, 2-5-1 for the Braves. A reminder, we'll be back with you next Sunday. When the Braves take on the Astros, it'll be Houston's final year in the National League. Next Sunday, 1 o'clock. Yeah. 2-2 pitch. Turdoslovich completely fooled by that one as he pulls off. And we've got free baseball here from Champion Stadium. 2-2 our score as we head to the 10th.
for the Braves All-Star Game versus the Futures on April the 3rd at Couray Field. Come see manager Freddie Gonzalez and the Braves take on former Braves skipper Bobby Cox and the team's brightest prospects. For tickets, go to Braves.com/FutureStars or call 678-277-0340. We'll be out there. Have that broadcast for you. Looking forward to it. Kind of a different twist to your typical spring training game. You know, not only get a chance to see the regulars in that ball game, kind of a final tune-up for opening day, but then you'll also get to see all the bright young stars on the other side.
Get to see Bobby Cox back.
Yeah, last year we had Bobby in the booth here. Maybe we'll get a cameo from Bobby before we're done here in Orlando.
He's been down here all spring, just taking in the sunshine and enjoying baseball.
Dusty Hughes is the new Atlanta pitcher. He is a left-hander, 5'10", 190-pounder out of Tupelo, Mississippi. Signed by the Braves as a minor league free agent back in November of last year.
Wow, just missed the corner. Hughes, Dustin wanted that pitch.
Hughes actually made the Minnesota Twins opening day roster last year. Had a couple of outings before they sent him down to the minors.
That's two close pitches he did not get from Jerry Lane.
Two-two pitch, swing and a miss.
Did a great job staying away from Brian Ward there.
Well, we've been talking about the rotation, who's going to start on opening day for the Braves. How about most career opening day starts for Atlanta? Phil Niekro. 9, Maddox 7. The only guy that I wasn't sure of on that list when the mighty Steve Graham threw this question at me in the odd hours of the night, Rick Mailer. That one kind of snuck up on me.
Well, I was a little surprised. Phil had 9 opening day starts, and I had a chance to see Phil. Matter of fact, yesterday I was the grand marshal for the Buford Little Leagues, and his grandson plays out there. So he was there with his sons, and his grandson is a pretty good shortstop. Phil, he's always in Gwinnett. Mm-hmm. We always see him up at the Gwinnett Stadium. And, what a great guy, man. He gets along with everybody. Great personality.
Hall of Famer. Nice play by Boscan, who's so reliable behind home plate. It's one thing to be a Hall of Famer. That's nice. But a lot of people have made the Hall of Fame. Very few have had a sandwich named after him, like Phil Niekro has.
The Nuxie. Pretty good sandwich, too.
It is. It's quite tasty.
Awful lot of corned beef.
I might have to eat one of those in the middle of one of our games this year, Brian. Just turn over the play-by-play mic, let you do a couple innings while I enjoy a Nuxie. What do you think?
It sounds good. I'll return the favor the next inning. You'll be the analyst and the play-by-play guy. Right.
That's trouble for everybody tuning in. 0-1 pitch is outside. Hughes kind of built like a left-handed Chris Medlin.
He's getting ahead of the hitters. He knows how to pitch.
Braves will have 6, 7, and 8 due up in the home half, but I wouldn't even wager a guess as to who's going to be hitting. We're at that time of the game where there's all kinds of changes.
Well, we know Durango will be leading off.
2-2 now. Swing and a miss, strike 3. How about that? Dusty Hughes mowing him down. We go to the Atlanta 10th, tied at 2. CSS. Today's game is brought to you by VisitFlorida.com. Unleash your Florida side at VisitFlorida.com. 2-2 game. As we enter the bottom of the 10th inning, a new pitcher for the Orioles. He is number 98, Kyle Simon. Kyle Simon. And here to give you a comprehensive scouting report on Kyle Simon is our own Brian Jordan.
Very tall. Looks about 6'5". Looks like he has a power arm. Expect some fastballs.
Good
but
stuff.
He has that three-quarter motion that I don't like. So he's going to be tough on right-handers.
Very good stuff, Brian Jordan.
Got the old-school sideburns working.
Luis Durango. Going to get things started. Pitch a called strike on the outside corner. Already the third baseman Adair cheating in on the grass. Durango, much like Constanza, they're almost facsimiles of one another and what they do and what they do well.
Slap hitter with the ball in play, uses speed. Don't have to be a power hitter to be successful at the major league level. You can hit 300, put the ball in play, use your speed, steal about 50, 60 bags. Had a pretty good career. You don't find a lot of Ricky Hendersons anymore. Guy that leads off, hits with power.
Yeah.
He can slap the ball anywhere. Boy, could he run.
2-2 to Durango, who hails from Panama. 5'9", 155-pounder. I am glad that the stolen base is back in the game. Baseball is resembling baseball again. 2-2 pitch, chopped to second. Oh, got caught in between, and it goes into right field for a base hit. They will give him an error, even though it was no contact. Clearly it was misplayed by Antonelli.
You can't hesitate. If you're going to take off in on a ball, you got to keep coming. You can't stop. Well, that ball will eat you up just as it did to Antonelli.
I thought he was going to keep charging. And
he
then
should have.
He just inexplicably put on the brakes there. And it was all she wrote at that point.
Don't you hesitate, you're going to be late.
So the leadoff man aboard for really the player of the game thus far, other than Mike Minor, of course, on the pitching side, Jordan Peraz, who's driven in both Braves runs.
Had a chance to show off his arm. Did make an error out there in right field. Trying to run the ball down right field line. But that was his only mistake of the day.
Simon a little preoccupied with Durango, who, as you would expect, is a stolen base guy, and it's a good spot to go grab one. I always used to love what Joe Morgan said about base stealers. It's one thing to put up numbers. Swing and a miss, there he goes, and he is safe. Stolen bag for Mr. Durango, and the winning run is now in scoring position.
That's just an excellent jump by Luis Durango, because that was an excellent throw by Brian Ward, showing his arm strength. And that ball was right on the money. But Luis was able to beat it out.
Brian, Joe Morgan used to say, I don't care about guys that put a lot of numbers up, steal a lot of bags. When the game's on the line, that's when you find out how good a base stealer really is.
That's right.
And there's a key spot right there. If you get caught, you're the GOAT. But he's got enough confidence in his game. Peraz was actually showing bunt there. Got Pasternicki on deck. Corners coming in. Bunt dropped down. Only play will be at first. And the winning run is 90 feet away.
Well, what can you say? Jordan Peraz is showing his repertoire. He can get it done. Robin runs and sacrifice bunt guys over. Great technique. He squared around early. Got on top of the ball. He went from up to down. He's continuing to impress this organization.
This will be a great sign here if Pasternicki can be the hero. Drawn in infield. Takes a fastball, a high strike call.
And you cannot do that in this situation. Man on third. You got the infield in. You got to be aggressive. You cannot let that first fastball get by you.
Outfield, little league depth. Bounces it to the right side. The play is coming home, and the tag is made, and he's out. Durango got caught, looked like on the back of the shoulder.
Well, Durango did his job. He ran on contact and passed Nicky. He just, you know, you got to have a better at bat here in this situation. You know, again, Mike, I go back to that first fastball. You got to be aggressive. You got to get a pitch that you can handle. Wow, that was pretty close.
Yep, right on the letters.
Pretty close. The pass to Nicky, he has to put a better swing on that ball. He just kind of waved at it, just trying to make contact, and you got to drive the ball somewhere in that situation.
Now Boscan swings and misses. There's Pasternicki at first. He's got some wheels. You could be aggressive here, try to get him in scoring position.
Well, I would do that if I'm Pasternicki. If I just hit a weak ground ball and couldn't get the run in, I'm at least trying to steal a bag. Put myself in position to win the game by scoring a run.
2-2 score here in the bottom of the 10th. The Braves held to just five hits today. Count evens up. One ball, one strike.
I'd love to see J.C. Boscan just get into one pitch here. Be the hero.
Slicer down the right field line. That's fair. It's trouble. It is.
That should be it.
A fair ball. Pasternicki rounding third, gets the green light, and the Braves will win it 3-2.
Ground rule double.
Oh, they say it.
Ground rule double.
And hop the fence. I beg your pardon. It hopped the fence. I thought for sure that ball was going to bang up against the wall. We are blinded to those corners here as the bleachers jut out. So to be honest with you, Brian, I couldn't see it.
I saw the outfielder's hands go up, which means the ball has bounced over the wall or is stuck in the yeah, you can't.
Not pretty much
angle.
What we saw.
Yep.
I didn't think that ball had enough bounce on it.
Good job by Boscan, driving the ball the other way.
Now Mejia with a chance to be the hero. Ground ball, left side, deep short. Going to take a strong throw. Got him. So after 10, that is your final score. 2-2, your final, a tie. We'll take a timeout here. We'll come back, wrap things up when we return. 2-2, your final score.